everybody, and welcome back to the third and final session for today. So to begin with, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Anastasia Pistofidou. In fact, Anastasia, you just moved on my screen there for a moment, so I didn't spot you. I can see you now. I invite you to share your audio and your screen. Anastasia, we kind of wanted to invite you really because you represent a new type of designer, really. So trained as an architect, but also involved in the development of textiles and the founder of FabLab in Barcelona. You represent the kind of designer that I think is emerging, that doesn't necessarily have a professional domain in the way that designers used to have, but a deep material expertise. And so it seems absolutely appropriate to invite you to present today. So thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Very glad to be here with you. Can you see my screen? Yes. So I am the co-founder of FabTextile Lab in IAAC FabLab Barcelona, and the co-founder of Fabricademy, a new textile and technology academy. I have been a member of the FabLab Barcelona amazing team, and I established the textile lab in 2013. So the FabTextiles tackles four domains. It is a multidisciplinary research lab. One of which is the biodesign that I'm going to talk to you today. Let's see as an overall view. We tackle digital fabrication, which we could say that in a nutshell, in a very, very, very quick description, could be a personalized local production empowerment. We tackle wearable technology, which is, again, very, very quickly senses augmentation. Parametric design, which we could say it is data-informed design, and biodesign. It's a question mark. It's a question mark because it's these kind of events like this that are trying to define this new discipline. And I guess that I am not the most appropriate person to define biodesign because I'm mainly a practitioner. I try to have a bottom-up approach from practice, and that it's kind of this upcoming also practice-based research. So I hope that through the examples that I will give and through the different research that we made within FabTextiles, we can kind of start defining small elements of the biodesign practice. I also co-founded the Fabricademy, Textile and Technology Academy, 2017. It is a program, educational program, that puts into a format of learning all of these practices that we do in the different fab labs all over the world. And fortunately, this program has since the beginning been hybrid, combining online and offline education. So with this current pandemic, it was very well adapted to continue growing a network where we have many peers all over the world that they are simultaneously learning and combining hands-on learning with online education. I will first talk about the bacterial dyeing research. What I want to say here is that I believe that one of our mission is also, and all of us as researchers, is to democratize access to technology. through DIY practices. The BioLab at IAAC FabLab Barcelona is a BioLab completely invented. One day with my partner Jessica Diaz from BioCentric Group, I told her, okay, tomorrow we are making a BioLab, and we found a space and we set it up. So it was not thought, it emerged as a need rather than it was planned and had the proper infrastructure. And I think that this also gives hope to many practitioners to work at their houses and their home labs that we are transiting nowadays. Firstly, we started working with bacteria that can produce color, chromobacteria, different kinds of cultures, Serratia americanescens, biosafety level 1, and also the Xanthinobacterium lividum, this purple one. And we use them to combine them with the textile dyeing. And basically, in this symbiotic relationship or mutualistic relationship, we call this question that is open to everyone, who is the designer? Is the bacteria the designer? Is it us? What we do in this case is that we prepare the culture and the medium, we do the tie-dye technique on the fabric, and then the bacteria gets inoculated and starts growing on the fabric, coloring it. I would say that after some time, this question, who is the designer, for me doesn't make any more sense. I think that I think that maybe who is a designer is more anthropocentric. Maybe it doesn't matter. Maybe nature doesn't ask who designed that. It doesn't matter. It's a matter of symbiosis. But this is an open question for an open discussion for all. We developed various projects within this practice, some in collaboration with some fashion designers within some European funds, others for our own proper showcasing and research. And this was this collaboration with the fashion designer that we made not only bacterial dyed fabric, but we also did alginate-based bio leather. So this one is what we named as black matter, is an alginate-based leather reinforced with fibers that completely acts like leather and feels like leather. And this was a very nice collaboration. Let me see if this will play. Because the designer wanted to take out a sustainable brand, and she started collaborating with different practitioners that they do their own materials. We are, of course, talking for craft. We are talking about, in fashion, it would be called haute couture, but trying also to combine it with contemporary practices. So we developed this technique of pouring alginate with activated charcoal for the black color and reinforced with fiber so that it can be completely sewable and worn. So, okay. And then another part of our research is the bacterial cellulose, the SCOBY culture or kombucha. Everybody knows this from the bioculture pioneer Susan Lee. I think it's very it's a kind of relationship that you start developing with the SCOBY kombucha culture, because at the same time you can use it for your own health, but also you can use it to create vegan leather. And within the lab, we made various experiments, and now currently we are able to produce big size kombucha leathers that then later we mold them and we let them dry into 3D forms. That can be compared in with a medieval traditional craft technique of molding leather for armature. It is the same more or less technique. In this case, you can see the millinery hat making, this kombucha leather hat, and also a laser cut kombucha bag made from some Fabric Academy students. We also work with mycelium. And it is interesting to say that each of the research, it takes us as amateur practitioners at least 1 year to be able to say that we can really reproduce it, do it in a stable way, and also teach it. So I think that mycelium, we are beginners in this in the lab. We have been trying to make it work for at least 2 years. And it is very fascinating also, as Paul Stamets says, that we believe that the future is partnering with mycelium. Both because you can make blocks and substrates, as I guess every one of you here know, but also for creating leathers and making it also being productive in the format of eating it recycled fibers that they are offcuts from the textile industry, or even making it grow onto formwork, textile scaffold, that we could use it, we could say it here, so that it can solidify the textile and, in a specific form. And also we use it again, in this case, one of my students in Fabric Academy, she wanted to create this public statue where she would inoculate with mycelium and then let it in open air to see how it digrades. And here was the first, let's say, big scale mycelium that we were trying to make. But not only in terms of using the mycelium, but also we used some mushrooms because we were foraging in the forest of Valdaura, where we have the Green FabLab, and we found this dyeball mushroom, which is used, it's very powerful mushroom for extracting the color. So we use it for textile dyeing techniques. And one of the mission of the textile of the FabTextiles is to be able to open source all of these practices. If you see, everything that we do is documented in a form of a tutorial so that people can actually follow. Of course, it's a trial and error based practice. So every year we learn more. And this is one open publication that we developed with Jessica Diaz. It's called Kickstart Your Mycoculture. So everyone can start making these mycelium substrates. Then another part of the research is the bio-based material, what in Fabric Academy we call crafted. In the contrary of the ones that I showed before, that they are grown. And now we are entering into the crafted materials. And they are, let's say, also serving as manifestos for material craftivism. One of the projects that we made was, again, with using activated charcoal, because activated charcoal is known for being able to filter the air contamination. Also, it's edible. And we use this to create a garment that we potentially, or let's say as a state of art, we thought that it would be purifying the air and making this us as consumers more responsible and more active within our context and environment. So these, all of these practices, they are in open publications. And this is something that I believe that has had the biggest impact in the community of practitioners, because even though they are not so scientific and they are not in perfect, because you know, you publish a book and then 2 years later you found out that you have many mistakes in the first book because you developed your practice. These publications have served a lot, many practitioners, to start with basic recipes that they can find and follow. And nowadays, we also have a lot of online tutorials for live making materials, live direct making materials that people can attend and they can start understanding the practice. So now I would like to show you some bio-based projects. How much time do I have?
You're at time now, Anastasia, but we do have a little bit of wiggle room here, so I don't want to stop you all while you're in flow.
Okay, so I will jump some projects and I will go to one that I think it could be more interesting for you, which is the one research of inflatable biomaterials that we have been trying to develop in the lab. Instead of using silicon or instead of using materials that are completely impossible to degrade, we developed bio-based inflatables. And this is a project of my student that she created the performance of a suit that was imitating her interior. So she created this bio-based guts and flasks and skins, and she was doing this research of the colors because not everyone has the same skin color, and she developed this inflatable gut that she was planning to inoculate with the bacteria, but the COVID came and she wouldn't be able to finish. In order to finish my presentation, I will just say that in the end, for all of us, we just need to be conscious, and it's a matter of us choosing which road we will take, because in terms of circularity, in terms of sustainability, you can create closed system loops using materials that they are not biodegradable, but you can also choose from the beginning to work with something that you can define its lifespan. This is a piece of art and a manifesto. It's called BioPantone, and it is a collaborative artwork of learning ancestral textile dyeing techniques with organic surplus. Thank you.